BBC Audio presents Doctor Who, The War Machines, by Ian Stuart Black, read by Michael Cochrane. Chapter 1, The Homecoming. Right on time, called the Doctor. Of course, he knew that, in one sense, time was a fiction. An attempt by man to measure duration with reference to the sun and stars. But he also knew that although such measurements were based on an impressive formula, all man's concepts were fraught with error. Time was not as it was supposed to be, for here they were, he and his single crew member Dodo, travelling fortuitously across space, splitting time into fragments, or more exactly, ignoring the passage of time, the rising and setting of the sun, the ebb and flow of tides, the coming and going of the galaxy in which they voyaged. "Stand by," called the Doctor. He had a split-second awareness of where they were, and knew how much it would mean to the girl, this homecoming. "I'm logging it on the computers," Dodo told him. "I've timed the entries. You can see it on the graph." It was odd she should talk about time. They had their own time in this encapsulated world of theirs, the TARDIS. "Watch the screen," she said proudly, pressing recall. The graph came up, a bold, splendid curve. Their progress was unblemished. He could predict exactly where they would materialize, but he said nothing. Mixed with the pleasure he felt about their arrival, the Doctor experienced a sense of concern, as though he were being given a whispered warning, an uneasy sensation. Dodo manipulated the instruments, sending a stream of data across the screen. In the past, Stephen had handled this task, but now he was no longer with them. She had taken over such calculations. It was still a new toy to her. There was a brief panoramic image of the city, into whose ambit they were emerging. Tall buildings were springing up where once Georgian squares had stood, where the rubble of a recent war had lain. Now the city had been rebuilt, and London rose very much as it was, and yet, to the Doctor's eyes, also very different. One style was going, one tempo was giving place to another. A generation had grown up which hardly remembered the carnage, and they were reconstructing their own capital. Perhaps the thing that caught the Doctor's attention, before he even saw it, in fact, was the tall, graceful tower that stood head and shoulders above the rest of London. What was it they had called it? The Post Office Tower? In all probability, they would change that name. But that was what they had first called it. The Post Office Tower, he repeated to himself. A symbol of recovery, he thought with satisfaction. He had always enjoyed England, and in spite of this warning whisper, he looked forward to this visit. It was almost a holiday feeling. He looked up at the screen. "Do you know where you are?" he called. Dodo saw the flickering pictures as they homed in. The focus steadied and cleared. The scene was suddenly familiar, and yet she didn't recognize everything. She couldn't be sure. But there, the bridges across the Thames, the parks, the great sprawling city. "It's London!" she shouted. She could hardly believe it. They had returned to her own town. But when? How much later than when she had last been here? Or perhaps it was earlier? That confused her. How could she be in a place her own world, older, even wiser, yet before she had left? Perhaps before she was born? The Doctor must have caught her thoughts. "A little time has passed, Dodo. You won't be out of place. What has happened or not happened will synchronize with you, and you will be totally accepted. You are back home." As they seemed to settle, That was the way she thought of it as the TARDIS materialized. The pulse died in the dynamos, and she could hardly wait to get out. To see her own people again, to breathe her own air, mix with her own kind, and be back in a world she had thought she would never see again. The doctor watched, saying nothing, but guessing that she had travelled with him for the last time. He would miss her, as indeed he regretted losing so many of his fellow travellers. The scanner played over the city below them. The sensors of the TARDIS, programmed by the doctor over many journeys, fed responses to the control factor, that area the doctor thought of as the brain. He drew her attention to the pictures on the screen. People were hurrying along a crowded street. "Do you see any changes?" he asked. She began to laugh. "Look at their hair, the length of it, even the men." The doctor saw little to laugh about. His own hair was as long as any man's in the streets of London on this spring day in the 1960s. "And the skirts," Dodo pointed, "they're even shorter, and so many are in jeans. What's happened to the old short back and sides and the smart jacket and ties?" "There are some," pointed out the doctor. "Not many." The screen showed a busy road, not far from elegant Regent Street. "It's like a holiday town," said Dodo. "I don't remember all those boutiques and that sort of music playing, certainly not from shops. And all the people are so young. It's as though a new generation has taken over London." "They've taken quite a step in that direction," agreed the doctor, a little critically. The scanner panned along a narrow alleyway. Perhaps it was still searching for an appropriate place to land. As they panned past the corner, Dodo saw the street name. "Carnaby Street," she frowned. "I don't remember that. It wasn't there before." "Everything changes," said the doctor. "It's all a fashion, my dear. What you and I think is solid and permanent is only a passing shadow. Part of the time you lived in, your own time, is a memory to these young people." A quiet, old-fashioned London square, one that had as yet not suffered the planner's vandalism, came up on the screen. And she guessed this was where they would make contact with Earth. The outer door opened. But at the last moment, Dodo didn't race out into the sunlight. She hesitated, running her hand over the structure of the ship around her. She had grown to love it, perhaps like the cave, the primitive safe place that mankind, and certainly womankind, had relied on since the beginning of time. And now, all at once, she had a feeling she was saying goodbye. "Come along," called the doctor breezily. He was not one for sentimental moments, nor for prolonging partings. He strode sharply to the door, and Dodo hurried after him. The square was something of a cul-de-sac, and the corner in which the TARDIS had materialized was tucked out of the way. A few pedestrians hurried past, and a couple came out of one of the houses. No one seemed to notice anything unusual. The doctor took a deep breath, savoring the bright morning. "Wonderful," he said. "Wonderful! What a pleasure to find ourselves here! What a homecoming!" said Dodo. "So you know where you are?" he teased her. "Of course. It's marvellous to be back. It's ages since I was here." He looked at her dryly. "When you've seen as many ages as I have, you won't use that term so freely. In fact, it's been no time at all." "Right, Doctor. Let's get moving." He was carrying a placard, which he began to fix to the door of the TARDIS. As he stepped back, she saw it was a printed sign. It read, "Out of order." She laughed. "What's that for?" He looked reproving. "The problem about being back in the 20th century is that the TARDIS could easily be taken to be what it appears to be."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.